The Cure Radio Show. Today we have a very interesting show. It's discussing how to avoid hell or escaping from hell, if it's at all possible. Do we still believe in hell, and who's at risk? In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful, and kindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created, and you will renew the face of the earth. O God, you taught the hearts of your faithful by the light of the Holy Spirit. Grant that by the gift of the same Spirit you may be truly wise, and always rejoice in his consolation. We ask this through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father. So it's another beautiful sunny day in Miami, where we are feeling blessed for another day to be woken up, to be healthy, and to be alive. Bobby wants to say hello.
Yes, hi guys.
He is here.
I am here. Okay. It's going to be fun. Hell definitely exists. Tune in and let's discuss more.
With all the evil that we have witnessed or experienced, there must be. I don't see any other way about it, but it's good to be aware, so don't worry, there's hope. There's God, and he's bigger.
Yes, but we need to do our part, otherwise it's not going to happen.
Well, this is a training ground. Somebody said every experience is a test, so if it is, let's pass it. That's my best advice.
Let's pass it.
Let's pass the test. Why not?
Let's do it.
I mean, if it is a test, or you can consider it a game. It's okay to cry. It's okay to fall apart. You don't have to try to be strong when you are not. And it may take some time to make sense of.
Sometimes I still catch myself trying to call your phone. All the hopes and dreams we used to talk about, they're still alive in me, and I just hope I make you proud. Now I'm your legacy, and it's your love still holding me together. And I still hear you say, it's okay.
The Cure with Aimee Cabo. Life can bring many difficult situations, domestic violence, addictions, poverty, and even sexual abuse by your loved ones. Welcome, Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
Good afternoon, and welcome to The Cure Radio Show.
And those who are joining us today.
I'm your host, Aimee Cabo, with my amazing partner, Boris.
And Lucy.
That one. Our show is available live on your radio, also live through our app, The Cure, on any smartphone, throughout social media, and our website, godisthecure.com. We broadcast live from Miami through satellite, available on traditional radio and on Sirius XM channel 131, the next day, also on any podcast player. We are now reaching approximately 5 million people monthly in Facebook alone. So thank you. And mostly, thank you to God. This show was created to expose the truth, educate, and provide comfort. We provide testimonials to let people know that we are not alone, And in this show, the testimony started with me. We also have experts and inspirational speakers that can help. God was my only cure when everything else failed, but I hope that at least we can be there for each other. Life can be challenging. We know this. But also know there is a God. He hasn't stopped loving us. He will always be our Father and will always be there. And it's always true. So there is hope. That song that just played was When We Fall Apart by Ryan Stevenson. Life is a test, allowing opportunities to let Him and grow. Trusting the Lord, we glow. And His truth, we will know. At different levels of our journey, at His holy pace, as His chosen, we all end up in the same place. Of the same minds and heart of flesh, to God's delight. Endure and give our life to Christ to do what's right. That these broken bones praise His holy name, true God and man, always in the game. Building us back up from every storm we weather. Miss you, Father. Anything can conquer together. Take our tears and share the joy. It's all you. With every trial, Christ helps us through. Sweet Jesus, thank you for the love and compassion. In all, down on knees, nothing like His passion. The reason to keep holding on and give rise to God, His will, should He make us wise. Today we will be talking about how to escape from hell with our special guest, David Gerrelli. Having had brushes with death through disease and addiction in David's early years, he became obsessed with what would await him once he drew his final breath. Decades later, David would apply his 25 plus years of experience working in a field steeped in logic and science, and would apply these skills to years of research in the field of near-death experiences. His research, tainted by God's own guilt, would take on a life of its own, revealing a dark and sinister aspect of this surprisingly common phenomenon. David Gerrelli is the author of How to Escape from Hell, Studies and Interpretations of the Afterlife. David, welcome to The Cure. So glad to have you with us.
Thank you, Renee. I'm really happy to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
David, so what do you suppose happens after we die? And what are near-death experiences?
So near-death experiences are surprisingly common. They account for about 5% of the population. And typically it's a experience that occurs either close to the moment of death or after the moment of death. A lot of people are familiar with things such as, I saw my life flash before my eyes. That's quite common out-of-body experiences. So those things typically come from near-death experiences. And it's a very, as I said, it's 5% of the whole population. It's a very common occurrence. And typically what happens in near-death experience is once somebody's had that experience, they come back and they tell us about it. And then there's various organizations that capture this information and report it. One organization is the Near Death Research Foundation, or ENDA, and there's the International Association for Near Death Experiences.
Yes, go ahead, I'm sorry.
Yeah, so when you look at, so over the years, there's actually some scientific studies that have been conducted over the years as it relates to near death experiences, and there's a kind of scientific metric for determining if a near death experience was actually a spiritual experience, or something like a hallucination from ICU, intensive care. It's called the Grayson scale. Yeah, so there's more science to this subject than people are aware. It's a lot more common than people are aware. And regardless of what we believe, imagine if these stories are true and these experiences are true, it means that there are millions among us that have met with God and Jesus and members of their Passover family. So it's a very interesting concept.
Wow, because, yeah, some people will tell you there's a euphoric feeling just before you die or just when you're about to die, and you can hallucinate, and the enemy will always cause doubt. That's his expertise. But I've seen it on social media. I've seen it, tons of stories where people they have messages and have, you know, near-death experiences. And so how do they determine what's a hallucination and what's an actual near-death experience? How do they determine what it is?
So they use something called the Grayson scale, and the thing about near-death experiences is each one is unique in its own way. But even with that being the case, and there are tens of thousands, I personally researched thousands of near-death experiences, so obviously my focus was more on distressing and hellish experience, but I still read thousands of positive experiences. And the way you determine if it's hallucination or whether it's someone's imagination is we have this concept called the Grayson scale. And Dr. Grayson developed a scale of common things that occur during an NDE. So this includes things like out-of-body experiences, increased perception, a more vivid experience, life review, so this is where your life flashes before your eyes, meeting dead loved ones, and there's quite a few of them I cover in the book, but using this metric, if something scores a 7 or above in the Grayson scale, then typically we consider that to be an actual NDE as opposed to something else. And it's interesting what you said about people who always cast out on NDEs and these experiences. And I think this is why, particularly in my book, I've tried to take a more scientific approach using data science and data analysis, because the people we want to reach are not just the faithful already. We want to try and reach people who are concerned or distressed and would benefit from having a connection to God and being aware that there's more to life than what we're living, right? And everything we do matters, and everyone is courageous and not to feel guilty and all these different things. So I always encourage people to go online, look at scientific studies. There are scientific studies in Virginia with Dr. Grayson. Even in Europe, there are studies taking place, and there is positive outcomes from those studies that reinforce the existence of near-death experiences.
Okay, so if I were to tell you that from doing drugs all night long, I had a convulsion and I passed out, and the person holding me describes me having turned blue, and all I can remember is that I was in a tunnel. It was pitch black, and it was very wide where I was going. I was very happy. I was so much at peace, and I was just thrilled, but I had to come back. The person that was calling me, mentioning my daughter, it kept coming in louder and louder, and I had to come back, and my legs were like spaghetti. I didn't see anything. I didn't, but the feeling was great.
It's very common.
I've heard that from other people, something similar. I mean, some people see the light, some people see darkness. So would that be a near-death experience considered?
Yes, it would be a near-death experience, absolutely. And lots of people have that experience. So for you, in particular, the darkness, the place you're in, most people describe it as, even though it's dark, it's not scary. They feel love, they feel content. They can stay there forever, right? Even though it's darkness. And it's an endless void of darkness. But there's no association with evil or pain or fear. It's always happiness.
No, I was I was actually mad I came back. For 3 days I was regretting it. Yes, we'll talk some more about this when we return.
We'll be right back. We'll continue talking more about near-death experiences and escaping from hell with David Gerrelli. Stay with us.
We will be right back with Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone.
Should I ever need remind of how I've been saved?
we will be Cabo and the Cure.
Welcome back, and thanks for tuning in. That song that just played was Another in the Fire by Hillsong and Taya. When he said, faith will move mountains, he was right. Hail the darkness to witness his mercy and might. God is great. Give him our fight. We'll be all right. Rain or shine, taken by his loving flight. If we don't see the miracles arrive still, it is quite well. Blessings and the good it will bring, only he can tell. Humbling at the least, be like him a little more. To the God we adore, another open door. We have come so far, but many lessons still to learn. More fires he puts out, painful memories to burn. Oh, of great concern to him, why Christ will return. Being only his, but mercy most we yearn. Holiness does not come easy, as labor causes pain. New life, light from darkness, due to his reign. He rules men's hearts and dwells within. Salvation at his feet, not cursed by sin. We will continue about escaping from hell with David Gerrelli. David, I think I get what you were saying, if there's no fear, that I did not wake up and say, or wake up with my mouth open and tongue sticking out saying, wow, I could have died, that was crazy, and not afraid, but wow, that was amazing, and I can't believe I'm back. and maybe that might be the small difference, but still, my experience was a little simple. Is there people that have had near-death experiences that have reported having experienced or seen hell?
Yes, there are. So, and actually, in most cases, when people go where you went, that voice, that darkness, that's where there's a kind of crossroads between heaven and hell diverge. So, for example, in your case, the voice told you to come back because you have more work to do and reminded you of your thoughts around, which is also very common. That's because God knows that once you're there, you don't want to go back, right? So you need some encouragement as to what, and again, that's very common as well. But from a hellish experience point of view, and it doesn't always necessarily begin in the void, but 5 to 8 times out of 10 it probably does, is for various different reasons. Either they immediately start to fall from this darkness, just down and down. And it's exactly what you would expect from a biblical perspective. There's, as they approach the kind of end of this abyss, as they fall, they can smell burning and sulfur. You know, like burning flesh, screams, and probably more importantly, that is that you feel the torment of those they're approaching. And the same for positive experiences is that when you have a positive experience, you feel the feelings and emotions and experiences of those that you're with in the afterlife or during your journey. And the same is true with hellish experiences as well. And so they'll fall into hell. And then really from that point forward, it's very much what you would expect it to be. Which in some ways explains why heaven exists in the first place, but you know, demons are very common. I think one of the things that stood out to me when I was doing the research is how these, I think, you know, it's important to pity those that are there. There's all manner of people in this place, and one of the overwhelming feelings that people feel is the desire by these poor souls to have others feel the way they feel.
Wow.
And in some ways, I think, is that so they can have a sense of community, right?
Oh, goodness.
And I think that's a human concept, yeah. Right? So,
right, misery loves company kind of thing. That's where that saying comes from, maybe. Yeah, I'm glad I didn't experience any of that. No, I was just laying flat in air, standing still, not going either way until I went back.
it's important to remember that only 4 to 12% of all are distressing. It's not as common as NDEs at all. It's a very small percentage of people. And I think, you know, in terms of the way hell, you know, the way hell is and what it's like, I think most people probably know to a large degree. There is also a place similar to purgatory. And now, bear in mind, this is based on thousands of witness accounts. This is not me reading from any kind of scripture or theological studies. This is purely from the accounts of people that went through what you went through, just to a more extensive experience. So this is what I was surprised when I was doing the research, to hear how it aligns very much with much of what we know today in terms of how purgatory and hell works. Purgatory was also quite distressing. It was also, as you would expect, a very lonely place.
There's different levels, and it can be a mini hell, but you still have a chance to get to heaven. That's the difference. There's different levels in heaven.
Yeah, absolutely.
And in holiness.
I mean, I've only discovered, exactly right. And I've only discovered two, right? So two levels, purgatory and traditional hell. And I guess what stood out most from the study was that there is a way for us to return to heaven and to leave hell. In some cases, people just came out of it because they were suffocated in their physical bodies on Earth. So they just came out of that experience and they were safe from it. And in other cases, and I can explain that. So one of the things about the human soul from the research is free will is a very powerful thing. And God allows us free will, right? We all know that we have the right to choose our own, make our own decisions, choose our own destiny. So in many ways, when people are in hell, and it comes to the root of why people are there in the first place, the kind of things that weigh us down, and it's that weight that takes us to hell, is when we punish guilt. Guilt is a negative emotion. Hate is a negative emotion. All of these negative emotions we pick up during our lives, when our time comes and it's time to cross over, we can't take those negative emotions into heaven. It's a place of love and positivity. So where did it go? What do?
You said something very interesting. Guilt is a negative emotion. What do we say about remorse? It's different.
Remorse is a part. It's a really good question. I've never been asked that before. I think remorse is a sense of conscience and empathy, right? So I think remorse is a positive emotion, but also, I think as much as remorse is a positive emotion, you still need to forgive yourself.
Right, don't beat yourself up. Don't hate yourself.
Yeah, exactly.
For sure, that's what the enemy wants.
Absolutely. Learn from it. Learn from your mistake. Whatever it is, learn from the mistake and move forward and past it.
The way I see it, if there's a consequence, it's wrong, it's evil. And if it brings about good, then it's from God. And that's how you know remorse is okay, and guilt is just doesn't get you anywhere, at least not anywhere positive. It only makes you feel bad about yourself.
Yeah,
correct. Yeah. Any negative emotion is happy, right? I think that's generally the concept. When you hate somebody, the only person you're hurting is yourself, not the person you hate.
Which is why God said, have only pure thoughts. And
correct.
Well, that does not constitute pure thoughts.
And we'll be continuing talking more about how to escape from hell if you can with David Gerrelli. Just stay with us and we'll discuss if he saw any proof that the demons are real. Be right back.
I've lived them.
We will be right back with Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
Welcome back, and thanks for being with us. Remember, we're live every Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern on your radio, on our app, The Cure, the podcast, The Cure, and our website, godisthecure.com, also throughout social media. That was Build My Life by Pat Barrett. Not about being right, but to God's will, what's correct. Heaven wasn't meant to be easy, few and select. Willing to fight hard battles head-on and direct, his precepts and holy words to respect. His mercy is gracious, but aim to fear God and obey. A servant and fisherman rather than evil's prey. He's our greatest interest, investing in Christ. Advance in grace, not being easily enticed. His creatures must be before concerns or any desire. Pray to be strong, resist, and stay out of the fire. Looks for soldiers to hire with an open heart. In his strong hold forever, never to part. Nothing like a relationship with him, hard to describe. Steadfast in his arms is where we want to arrive. Call on Christ, holds the world, many to save. All he does and so much that God gave. We will continue talking about escaping from hell with David Gerrelli. And if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than with 2 feet to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with 1 eye than with 2 eyes to be thrown in hell, where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Mark 9:44-49. David, how do we best avoid hell?
So I think in terms of avoiding hell, ultimately from a faithful point of view, we were taught about love, right? And I think if we use love as our guiding principle as we move through our lives, then you know, we stand the least chance of going to hell. But also, importantly, at least in my research, and again, I wasn't doing biblical research or theology, it was just based on his witness account, there's a very strong component of self-guilt. So guilt is a very heavy negative emotion, very heavy negative energy, and it's heavy enough to drag you down to hell. Hell is a negative place. And so if you carry negativity with you at the time you cross over, then it's going to weigh you down, right? That's what the research told us. And so, in order to avoid, I mean, I don't know if you guys are familiar with the concept of the life review. So this is a very, very, I mean, almost 100% of all NDEs have this experience. And it's where they go through their life either with God or with some other spiritual guide, and they review the things they've done in their life. And what's unique about that experience, and some people find comfort in this, is God or whoever your guide is in that experience will show you parts of your life where you've hurt something, where you've done something bad towards somebody, where you've mistreated or, you know, whatever it may be. And during that experience, you feel the way they feel throughout your entire life. You see and feel everything that person that you hurt saw and felt at that time. And you need to process that. And so so it's going to be a tough process to go through, to be honest, if you've led a particularly evil life and you may have hurt a lot of people, or you just didn't care for people, or you've chosen fear over love. This is the time it's going to become most apparent. So most importantly is try and live a positive life. And I always say, take a moment to look around you and care for the people that are close to you and around you. And if you're weighed down by all of this self-guilt and self-hatred, just process it and let it go. One other thing as a kind of side effect that came out of the study is life is more courageous just to be here on earth, to be quite frank. And all of us have a path. Everybody has a journey of their own. And you were sent back because you hadn't completed your path, right? So, and because you have more work to do. And so knowing that everything you do in your life, everything that happens that is wrong, everything you feel bad about, there's a reason for it. There's a lesson to take from it. Look for the lesson.
Yes.
And grow from that.
And it's very interesting that you said the best way to avoid hell is love, because it's not just love for one another and love for self, but love for God. And not only that, to believe in God's love for you. Because I know that guilt can be destructive. It had me in many years of depression. It can drive someone to suicide. And it's mostly not that I did not believe God could possibly love me. And that was a big lie, because he would not have given up his only son if that was the case. And so that's how I know demons are real, I dealt with them. I fought with them. I know that they changed my way of thinking, my perception, and God allows that. Just like he allowed so many things to happen to Job, God allows the devil to change your thinking, change the way you feel. And those are some of the tests that we have to go through, just like Job did. And don't worry, God will give us equipment to deal with it. He will give us what we need. He doesn't allow us to go through anything we cannot handle. But we must always stay close to him and always pray and always humble ourselves before our God so that we can open up his heart enough to receive his mercy. How do you know demons are real? Thank you, David. What's your take on demons being real?
So just to pick up on your previous point.
Sure.
We never go through anything that God didn't plan for us to go through. And so whenever we can be sure that we're equipped and capable of getting through it. So I just wanted to, that was something else that came out in the research, but I just wanted to validate that comment that you made.
Thank you.
So from a demon point of view, demonology, the reason that, and again, this is across thousands of records, witness accounts, people that have had an experience after dying and reported it and come back, this is where the data comes from. And demons do occur in that 12% of all hellish experiences. And I think it's more awful and horrifying than we think. There are many cases where a witness can't even describe what they're seeing because it's so horrific, you know, way beyond anything that we've seen in any kind of human drawing or painting or depiction of demons.
They're invisible. They're invisible. And they use our loved ones. They can use our animals. They can use anything to try to cause conflict, to try to get us to get upset. Let's not get upset at the person. We're not against flesh and blood.
These
we're against like principalities of darkness.
Real demons that people saw.
Yes, but there's demons that are around us that we experience. But you're telling me that people did not just have near-death experiences, they actually saw demons?
This is people that had near-death experiences in heaven. So these are demons in hell, right? So
in hell.
In terms of demons, so the question, do demons exist? Based on the research, I know they exist in hell. Do they exist on Earth? I haven't personally investigated the existence of demons here on Earth.
Well, has anybody ever been really mean to you? That's a demon behind it. There you go, you've experienced it. I'm sure at one point or another someone's being mean to you. That's the demons,
yeah, for sure.
You know, of course, we have the ability to fight it, but a lot of times we're used and abused. True story.
Yeah, absolutely. So, yeah, for sure. And I think that in terms of, from a hellish, there was actually one interesting situation just kind of connecting demons in hell with demons outside of hell. Is there was one experience where a lady was with her husband, and she had she'd been through chemotherapy, and she was recovering from it, and mm-hmm. she had a near-death experience on the beach with her husband, and as she kind of passed away from life, her husband was trying to give her bring her back by using respiratory techniques, and he felt fire, and he saw burning fire and burning come out of her chest, but when the doctors arrived, there was no such thing on her chest. So there must have been some kind of connection between hell and Earth at that particular point. You know, from my point of view, as a study on the book, I didn't really get into that concept. I did look at theology around demons, the different types of demons that exist around the world in terms of scripture, which was quite interesting. But from an in-hell perspective, it was pretty horrifying what I read about.
That seems pretty horrifying. The Bible describes hell as terrifying and a horrible place. Hell is described as eternal fire, unquenchable fire, shame, and everlasting contempt. A place where the fire is not quenched and everlasting destruction. Lake of burning sulfur, where the wicked are tormented day and night, forever and ever. So obviously, hell is a place we should avoid at all cost. Even if it means doing what's difficult, it's not as difficult as being in hell. Trust me, do it now, you're better off. It's even easier here than in purgatory. Don't settle for that. That's settling for less is more than settling for less. This is our chance. Let's not take it for granted. So, but when we return, we're going into break, and when we return, we'll talk about purgatory. There's people that don't believe in purgatory. We'll clarify that.
Yeah, interesting topic. And then whether we can leave purgatory.
Of course we can.
Okay.
That's why it's purgatory. It's another chance. God is good like that. He keeps giving us chances, but we only have so many.
We'll be right back.
We will be right back with Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
There's a name that can silence every fear. There's a love that embraces the heartache, the pain, and the tears. Through my faith and my doubting, I know one thing for sure. His word is unfailing, his promise secure. Todo va a estar bien, everything will be alright. Whole world's in his hands, your whole world's in his hands. In the darkness and the trials, he's faithful and he is true. The whole world's in his hands. It's all lost time, yeah. Oh, 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 everything will be alright. Oh, 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 yeah. Father, you said everything is gonna be alright. But my circumstances say I won't last through the night. I need your word to hold me now, I need you to pull me through. I need a miracle, a breakthrough, I need you. They say you hold the whole universe in your hand, but my world's falling apart like it is made of sand. Am I small enough to slip through the cracks? Can you take my broken pieces and put them back? Give me faith, you believe, you are on my side. Open my eyes to see you working in my life. Let the past remind me you never fail.
And now we will continue with Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
Hi again, and thanks for tuning in. We're live every Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern on your radio, on our app The Cure, and on social media. Look for God is the Cure, because He is.
If you like podcasts, you can find the show as a podcast, God is the Cure. Just look for it and please subscribe.
That awesome, amazing song was Be Alright by Evan Kraft. Look up at the amazing sky to see God's sweet caress. Nonetheless, at our side to forgive this holy mess. A great healing love that nothing takes away. Constant presence, those who often pray. See the goodness of God and keep eyes on the prize. By walking in faith and disregard evil's disguise. Twisting facts into lies. God is truth and hope. Joy in his works shows us ways to cope. It works out for the best. Those few who choose Christ. Justified by his blood, this passion can't be priced, but in supplication to be treasured and adored, as we prayerfully admire our sweet Lord. Rain or shine, it doesn't matter, our Lord's still sublime. Amazing what he will do for us at a drop of a dime. Corrects so we grow in virtue and start to shine, as predestined by birth in his mighty design. We will continue talking about escaping hell with David Gerrelli. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. John 3:16. David, what about purgatory? It's that we were talking about, some people just don't believe it. They don't think there's such a thing. Is there any near-death experiences where people saw purgatory? I saw on Facebook once a saint, I think she was a nun, a priest was in purgatory. She had an apparition, and it was of the priest suffering fires, surrounded by fires, as if he was in hell. Is it possible?
Yeah, so purgatory does.
Yes, go ahead.
So it does come up in purgatory. It's not as common as more traditional hellish experiences, but purgatory does come up. I found, as I said, it's only 4 to 12% of all NDEs that are distressing, so the kind of data is somewhat limited. But in terms of purgatory, it did come up a few times, and I've actually got a whole chapter in the book just on purgatory. And purgatory is a place of unending anguish and almost depression. You know, it's not as chaotic as hell, you know, so at least based on what I've read, this is not my own personal experience, but one of the really interesting accounts that I found was that a young lady found herself in purgatory, and she was in a long, long line, as far as the eye could see, of just white, kind of ghostly-looking people, still human form, but pale and ghostly, looking at the ground, just forever walking in one direction, and forever, and she tried to engage with these people to say, hey, what's going on, where am I? But no, everyone just mumbling to themselves about how sad they are, or something they've done, how much no one loves them, whatever they were mumbling about, but it was all kind of very negative things they regretted about their lives, but they mumbled. So yeah, purgatory does come up, again, not as common.
And
it does happen.
I suppose it depends on what level you're in. I read in explaining the demonic, there's different levels for everything. So is it unloving to warn people about hell and judgment? And does God predetermine who goes to hell and who goes to heaven?
So you're asking if God determines who goes to hell and who goes to heaven?
Yes, that would be the question.
Okay. So based on the research I did, and now bear in mind, I may not have the full picture, right? This is based on near-death experience accounts. But the thing that takes us to hell is our own negativity. So the way we perceive. So for example, if you think you deserve hell, then you're probably going to go to hell. You know, if you are so weighed down by negativity and hatred and contempt, then you're probably going to go to hell. If you can't get through your life review because you cannot face up to, or you cannot learn from, not face up to, it's not punishment. If you cannot learn from what you did wrong in your life and how you mistreated people and you chose hate over love, then that could also be a reason. Based on the research, you could go to hell. So really, the outcome was going to hell is very much about cleansing yourself. And you could say of sin, right? I would say that's probably a really good analogy, cleansing yourself of sin and forgiving yourself.
Yeah, I don't know so much if it's predetermined, but I think it has something to do with God's judgment. I mean, God is a just God, and we are rewarded according to our works. And if our works are evil, well, we are rewarded for that too, but in a bad way. So, yes, there is God's justice. And if we're doing good works, that would bring us closer to God, virtue. And so we wouldn't be thinking negative. We would have a new mind. We would be a new creature. We'll most likely go to heaven. And it is a choice. It's a choice to have faith, and it's a choice to love God. We all have to make that choice, or we can love the ways of the world, which is only temporary. And in the end run, the devil's only nice for so long. He eventually drops you like a hot potato when he sees that he finds no more need of you. I'd take God's side. He's more powerful, he's bigger, and he's forever, and he's true. He's not going to hurt you. He's not going to backstab you or betray you, which is the way that anything in this world might, and everyone.
Completely agree. I think the thing he said to heaven as well, right, is that a place of absolute love and joy. And, you know, obviously we all want to go there. I agree. I think whatever we think about life, choosing love is always the right answer. And being courageous as well, to the point you made earlier. You know, we were destined for the path we've taken.
Spiritual courage.
Being courageous to get through it.
Right. Don't fail to do. Step outside your comfort zone. Say what you're afraid to say. Do what you think. Do what everybody thinks you shouldn't do, but you know that God is pushing you to do it. The devil will always instill fear, especially when it comes to helping someone. Oh, no, that person's too scary to help. Well, who cares? God will provide. And if something scary happens, God will still provide. And if things go wrong, then God will make sure I learn something from it or something good comes about it. So basically, do not be controlled by fear. I'm actually always, you know, running into situations like that. I've tried to learn, live and learn. I hope we all do. So, and so in the last minute, David, 18 seconds, any last minute advice for our listeners?
Yeah, I would say have strength and courage, and learn from anything that you feel guilt for in your life. Learn from it and move on from it, and do not hold on to that guilt.
And remember that.
That would be my biggest lesson to take away.
And remember that Jesus said unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. Luke 15:10. So David, you have been scientific proof that hell exists. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you, and
thank you for your service. Thank you for making people aware and bringing light, shedding some light into the darkness. So we will finish with a prayer, as we always do. A prayer to avoid purgatory. Or hell in that case. Because if you can avoid purgatory, you can avoid hell. That was composed by Joseph Cafasso.
Saint Joseph Cafasso.
Oh, Saint Joseph Cafasso. My bad. Oh, my sweet Joseph, in addition to the many graces which thou hast conferred on me in the course of my life, I asked thee for this further one. When my soul shall have departed from this world, not only that it not be condemned to hell, but that it shall not be compelled to remain away from thee, or even a moment in purgatory. It is true that I am a debtor to divine justice, but I hope to pay all my debts from the infinite merits of thy passion and death. My God, I accept whatever kind of death that it may please thee to send me, with all the terrors, all the pains, all the sufferings that shall justly accompany it. Finally, I pray thee to accept the destruction of my body as the last act of homage that I can offer to thy supreme majesty, in satisfaction for the offenses committed in the course of my life. O Mary, I ask thee for one more grace. Obtain from thy divine Son that I may die, but that I may die with thee, and that I may fly to heaven along with thee. O merciful Mother, grant that when my soul is liberated from this wretched body, I may go immediately to find thee in heaven, there to commence that life which will be my occupation for all eternity. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the wonderful people that work with us, for having us in the air. We're still on. God is good. Please check out Robbie Dilmer's show. Awesome guy. He's right before me. Kingdom Pursuit and the Christian Car Guy. Really funny guy. You'll love it. This is Aimee Cabo. You have been listening to The Cure.
Please check our podcast, The Cure with Aimee Cabo, and our app, The Cure.
Thank you to our listeners for being with us, and until next Saturday, much love. Always give it your best. Be as kind as possible to yourself and everyone. True in every situation. Keep your values. Don't lose hope. And most importantly, keep the faith. And peace be with you. God's peace.
Thank you for listening to The Cure with Aimee Cabo. For more information or to get Aimee's book, Love is the Answer, God is the Cure, or to listen to the podcasts of previous shows, visit godisthecure.com.